What is up, brothers and sisters? It's Jay Campbell, and you're listening to the Jay Campbell Podcast. Join me for regular deep dives with amazing beings whose work is manifesting a golden age. And remember, you create your reality by your focused thoughts, conscious words, and intentional actions. Raise your vibration to optimize your love creation. Hey guys, what's up? It's Jay Campbell, and I'm making a quick commercial here for aseercustom.com, my revolutionary cosmeceutical peptides company, co-founded with my business partner, Nick Andrews, who happens to be one of the world's top formulators. We have the revolutionary Oxano Grow, which completely regrew my hair. If you guys saw my hair about a year ago, I was almost bald. I even had the micropigmentation program from Advantis. And now I've completely regrown my hair. That's just with version one. Version two is now in the marketplace, or will be very, very soon. And it is 3 to 5 times as more effective than the current version or the original beta version of Oxano. We also have Royal Blue Serum and Sky Blue Cream, which will completely upgrade your face. I mean, I'm almost 50 years old. I have a pretty good complexion. I use it regularly. My wife swears by it. It will reduce fine lines and wrinkles, dramatically improve elasticity, and just the overall look and feel of your face. You feel great on both of them. You can also use them with red light therapy. There's all sorts of great stuff. So go to aseercustom.com. And if you're a first-time customer, use the coupon J15 to take 15% off your purchase. I appreciate all you guys, and I send you tremendous love and light. Well, what's going on, everybody? It's Jay Campbell. And of course, you are now on the Jay Campbell Podcast. And I'm very excited to be joined today in my new and improved StreamYard virtual studios with an awesome brother and good friend of mine, Dr. Brandon Chastain. Brandon, how are you, brother?
I'm fantastic. Very happy to be here.
It's awesome to have you here today. So you guys, let me give you guys a little bit about Brandon's bio. So he is literally the type of doctor, if you are needing optimization, that you work with. 15 years, actually more than 15 years experience in specializing in men's health, testosterone optimization therapy or testosterone replacement therapy, whatever you want to call it. You know, of course, HCG, erectile dysfunction, and growth hormone optimization, which I really love that about him. He's also very, very experienced in prescribing peptides. He is a Jay Campbell recommended and preferred physician. And you guys will find out much more about that in this show. Brandon, let me just ask you, as I've been doing a lot lately now on the Jay Campbell Podcast, today for record is Thursday, June 3rd. What is your thought process now on what is going on in the world? Obviously, you know, we're, you know, 18 months into the COVID, but obviously for guys like you, it's actually made the world better because now you can offer your services to really anyone, right? Because everything has been relaxed. You know, telemedicine is now the big thing. People are afraid to leave their homes due to whatever the COVID thing is. So can you kind of just like talk about like how it's evolved your practice?
Absolutely. So, you know, I've been doing telemedicine for 12 years now. And so it was very interesting. So before COVID even started, I had set my entire practice up from the scheduling to the charting to the front office to the phone system to be able for myself and my entire staff to be able to work remotely. And that was from a selfish motivation because I don't like to stay in the same place all the time and I like to move around and have different experiences like that. So when COVID hit, literally from a Wednesday night at 5 p.m. to Thursday morning at 9 a.m., I sent everybody home on Wednesday night. We flipped everything to our telemedicine program, and we had no blips in our patient care, which was a huge, huge blessing for us. I know a lot of other clinics struggled quite a bit, and many of them actually went out of business because of it. But you know, when COVID first started, one of the things that I was saying to everybody around me was that the shining star out of this whole situation is going to be telemedicine. I've been waiting for this change to come for a long time. So, you know, COVID, I think, just accelerated that. So I was very happy to see that. But for my practice in particular, Even though that we were doing it before, we converted a lot of our patients and were able to accept and to treat a lot more patients who weren't in my general, you know, 5 mile vicinity of my physical clinic. So it's really just transformed everything for our clinic, my ability to help. You know, we do men and women's health. I have a female doctor in my office as well, who also does telemedicine. So it's just really transformed and expanded everything in terms of the people that we're able to help.
That's awesome, man. And of course, I was going to say that when I was going over your stuff and, you know, I said men's health, but yes, he works with women because obviously I have a huge number of women that, of course, are in my audience and follow me now. So that's huge. And we'll talk about that at various points in the show for sure. Let's talk a little bit more about telemedicine. I think that people right now still don't really understand what's going on, right? Like, you know, talk about like who you can work with and who you can't work with.
So, you know, the telemedicine laws are different in each state. So in general, at least on the West Coast, as long as the physician is licensed in the state where the patient is located, then it's a completely legal interaction. You know, it's unfortunately, it's a huge gray area still. So, you know, if a patient, for instance, that I've been seeing for 15 years in Arizona moves to a state that I'm not licensed in, you know, there's just a gray area in that way.
Sure.
I personally have patients all throughout the country. Many of them commute. They have homes in different areas. They come into Arizona or California occasionally or whatever it may be. So, you know, I think that's still evolving at this point. But, you know, like I said, I have patients from east to west coast, north to south.
That's awesome. Yeah. And you know, as a guy who's like, you know, very conversant with the telemedicine laws, it is nebulous. It is very gray. I definitely don't know now though, with COVID, they've so laxed the restrictions. As long as you do everything correctly, you know, from obviously a patient administration, you know, onboarding and all the stuff you do. And I'm going to get to why you're so amazing in that regard in a second, but I feel like you probably have more capability than even you know, right? Like what I mean by that is, yeah, if somebody comes from the East Coast and says, hey doc, you know, I watched you on a podcast with Jay Campbell and you really resonate with me and I want to work with you, you know, there's a much easier way now for you to like reach out to them and say, well, go on my website, download all my forms, you know, do everything legally that you have to do to be able to work with me. And the likelihood that you're quote unquote, you know, going to get in trouble is slim.
Absolutely.
Because the DEA and the FDA and the state medical licensing boards and every other, you know, acronym company out there that may or may not care has a lot more other bigger fish to fry and more urgent things on their plate. Right. So, you know, yeah. I like to say that, and you're ground zero. I mean, you have 15 years working with male and female endocrine systems, managing them effectively. You're the type of doctor, obviously practice, that people must work with because, and Brandon, I want your comment on this. And obviously I harangue on this all the time, but the days of relying on the family doctor,
yeah,
right? The sick care, PPO, HMO, you know, my benefits give me access. That shit is done. You know, yeah. We are now in a new era and people must work with specialists like yourself if they want to seek optimization. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Absolutely. You know, I think a lot of people don't really realize because they end up going to their PCP originally if they're having low testosterone symptoms. And what they don't understand is I don't care what kind of practitioner you are. You can be an MD, DO, naturopath, PA, NP. It doesn't matter where you went to school or what your degree is in. You do not get taught this in medical school.
No.
So if you are not doing continuing medical education courses and requirements after medical school on hormone optimization, and that's different. That's the difference between what you said earlier, testosterone replacement therapy versus testosterone optimization therapy.
Exactly.
If you're not specializing in this after medical school, then you don't know what you're doing. And that's just the reality of it. So a lot of primary care doctors, a lot of them wisely will not prescribe testosterone or hormones and things like that because they're worried about everything else. They're worried about your blood pressure and your blood sugars. And, you know, they go to their continuing medical education requirements about this overview of your health. They're not looking specifically about these things. And the ones who will prescribe are testing improperly, dosing improperly, you know, all of these things. Or if you come in 1 point above the normal range on your levels, then it's not a testosterone problem for you. It's something else. It must be, you know, psychological.
Dude, it's incredible, man. Yeah. Like, there are so many ways we could go with that. I mean, yeah, I mean, so back to the educational component of things. If you're a physician and you're in the optimization space and you're a cash pay doctor, you absolutely have to continually educate yourself. You have to go to these conferences. You have to go to these, you know, licensing, you know, agencies, you know, advanced courses, peptides, hormones, whatever, because dude, this is such an ever evolving space. I mean, I, you know, for myself, as you know, we've been to the same conferences together. We actually never connected. But we've been to these things, you know, over the last 3 or 4 years, and it's mind blowing, as you know, Brandon, to see what it was like in 2015 to what it's like now. I mean, it's a whole different world. You know, you and I were talking off air, and we'll talk about it right now, but like, just with the awareness of prescribing, you know, estrogen inhibitors, selective estrogen receptor modulators. I mean, all of these things, which were like standard of care for hormone optimization physicians, are now like not even used at the tip of the spear. So it's like the change from 2015 or 16 to 2021 is like night and day. So can you speak a little bit about that? Like, if you're a patient or a prospective patient and you're watching this podcast right now and you're working with a testosterone windmill clinic, how do you know you should find another doctor?
So there's a lot packed into that question. So,
you know, you're just the guy to answer it, bro.
You're exactly right. In the last 5 to 6 years, there have been dramatic changes and dramatic, steps forward in this realm. And unfortunately, many of these mill type clinics are still practicing exactly the same way that they were back then. Exactly. And they're not going to the continuing medical education, all that.
They're killing guys, bro.
Absolutely. Absolutely no question about it. You know, what we were discussing earlier off air, you know, estrogen is a perfect example in this regard. So historically, hormone replacement doctors and hormone optimization doctors like myself, historically, if you put a guy on testosterone, you immediately at the same exact time put him on an AI like an estrogen. Right. And you did that because the thought, which was 100% not backed by research, was that estrogen is bad for guys. And if you give testosterone, we know already that it converts into estrogen. And then you're going to get gynecomastia, man boobs, you're going to have prostate effects, you're going to have feminization, all these other things. And what we found when the actual research was done in the last handful of years is that that's absolutely not the truth. Your estrogen or estradiol level is extremely important for men, as it is for women. You see the same thing happen to women after menopause. A woman loses her estrogen after menopause, and her risk for cardiovascular disease goes up dramatically to the level of a man. So in a man that's on testosterone, if you're blocking his estrogen, you're actually increasing his risk for cardiovascular disease. Beautiful. So, you know, and it's a challenge because a lot of the labs, including the big, you know, the big box labs like LabCorp and SnoraQuest, they haven't caught up to the new research.
No.
So I have to have this conversation with almost every single one of my patients when they say, well, is my estrogen level, my estradiol level is 70. It shows that it's elevated. That's I mean, right. Yeah. And I sell them. I'm like, that's perfect. That's exactly where I want you to be. Don't do anything differently. You don't need to block that. It's perfect. It's protecting you from a cardiovascular standpoint.
That's going to be a blurb, bro. That's going to go all across social media. That was amazing. I mean, where do I start? There's a lot to unpack in your answer. you're 100% right. And, you know, to your credit, there isn't 5% of doctors that could say what you just said. Okay. Because as you know, they're running their practice based on whether or not they're going to get in trouble by the state medical licensing authorities, right? Like, no, Jay. I mean, how many times have I heard this conversation? You have to keep them within that narrow confined range because if I don't, I'm not covering my ass. I mean, look, we know that medicine is evolving, but we also know that at the end of the day, you took a Hippocratic oath to ensure that your patient is feeling good. right? And if you're keeping a man who's on therapeutic testosterone in that absurd lab corp, as you call it, big box lab company ranges, you're harming them. I mean, shit, dude, what do they want them like between 18 and 35 or what is it, 22 and 40? I mean, that's absurd. Any man, well, let me back up. Those were not created for men utilizing therapeutic testosterone. And they were not created in the environment of today where the contamination from all causes, from our phones, from the screen that you and I are talking on right now, to the plastic in the water bottle, to the navigation systems in our car screens, to the shit in the plastic and the petroleum distillate in the cars. I mean, dude, we're being annihilated. And to think that, you know, you're supposed to conform to keep your estrogen or estradiol in that narrow range is preposterous. And yet, right, as you said, there's all these doctors out there, and I won't name names, even though I could, who are attempting to keep guys in them, and they are harming their health because, Brandon, and let's get deeper, testosterone must convert into estrogen or aromatize into estrogen to confer protection to biological systems. Estrogen is what is giving you the protection. It's not testosterone. Testosterone is the gas, but estrogen is the igniter. If you don't have healthy levels of estradiol, which is obviously ultimately estrogen, in your system, which as you said 70, I've seen guys that have 130 and are amazing. Mm-hmm. But that's what we have to focus on. And this is where so many people are lost. And as you know, the idiots will quote, you know, broken state studies with comorbid population groups where 100, if you have a 90 estrogen, you're going to get cancer. I mean, how many times have you heard this utter nonsense? But again, ultimately, testosterone must cleave through aromatization to that natural, you know, biochemically unique individual's level. And some guys are going to be 60 or 70. You know, I'm usually somewhere between 75 and 85, and you'll see that. And, you know, some guys are 120.
Yeah.
But there's nothing wrong with that as long as you do not have symptomology. And again, it's unbelievable how many people get this wrong. And as you said, 5 years ago, 6 years ago, it was considered to raise testosterone and to suppress estrogen. You know, we don't want men becoming like women, blah, blah, blah. And then you ended up hearing the term estrogen dominance. And that doesn't even exist. It's visceral fat and inflammation that is creating the irritation, the biological perturbations. And that's what blows my mind is that docs, I mean, dude, like I said, you're in the elite group. There's not a lot of docs out there. There are very big named physicians who still will not agree to what you and I just said. And it's not even a matter of agreement. This is fact. This is not debatable.
Exactly. And that's the whole point. You know, like I said before, you know, the thought of blocking estrogen before was not backed by research. It was not backed by fact. What you just said is exactly the truth. Today we have the research that the fact that well conducted research studies that prove this to be true. And then, you know, if you just logically think about it, if a woman loses her estrogen levels, and of course we're talking about very different, you know, amounts of estrogen in our bodies, but right, if a woman loses her estrogen levels, and we know in conventional medicine that her risk for cardiovascular disease then equalizes with a man's when she's producing her own estrogen, she's at a much, much lower risk of cardiovascular disease, heart attack, stroke, atherosclerosis, clogging of the blood vessels, all of those things. When she loses it after menopause, she equalizes with a man.
Exactly. It's crazy.
Estrogen is heart protective, you know?
Exactly. It's just a fact. And to that point, I'm glad you brought that up. You know, the tests that show the most protective effects for vascular protection are in women who have estrogen levels at 70, which is the minimum protective effect in the tests. So how could you extrapolate that a man should be, you know, 18 to 30? And dude, look, let's be honest. How many guys have come to you that you had to, you know, un-F, right? From working with the windmill clinics who had destroyed them, who had pushed them. I mean, again, how many guys do you know have come to you who had literally single digit estradiol levels from being on an AI for God knows how long and are coming to you and they're like, doc, I feel like I'm going to die.
Mm-hmm. I see them every single day, and it's very, very sad because the first thing I do, I mean, they feel terrible, you know, but my testosterone level is optimized, but I have no estrogen. I just feel terrible. I have no libido. I'm depressed, all of those type of things, you know? And so when you take them off, optimize them, kind of fix their endocrine system, it's amazing the changes that happen.
How long does it take you to get those changes though? Cause I think this is an important question because I've never asked this on my podcast before. And obviously I've had a lot of great docs like you on there, but I want to ask you because this is where guys are, doc. Let's be honest. The average clinic is fucking guys up. I don't like using that word on my podcast, but it's demonstrative and it's true. I had a guy call me this morning, not call me, but he emailed me, wanted to call me. I'm like, no, dude, you got too many issues. But I mean, he was the perfect guy. He was 39. He's been on testosterone for 5 years. He was at 160 when he got tested at 34 and he feels like death. It's just this long litany. And I, you know, wrote him back and I said, bro, join my mastermind. I don't want to like have an hour call with you, you know, join my mastermind and I'll tell you to work with Dr. Brandon. Right. But it's like, these guys are literally exactly as you just described them. They are destitute. They have high free testosterone and total testosterone levels, but they've been on an AI for literally 3 or 4 years. They're near death. So the question is, if you're that guy, you're watching this podcast right now, and you now know that you have to stop the AI, and there's other things that, you know, Brandon would help you with, but how long will it take you to get a guy who's been absolutely quacked for 3 or 4 years back to where he feels good?
So that's a very individualized thing. There's a lot of factors there, of course, like not only the AI, but if they're taking finasteride and they're blocking their DHT. So, you know, and it goes back to what you were saying too, environmentally. Does this guy have a whole lot of adipose or fat tissue on his body and he's eating like crap and he's not working out and all of those type of things? So the guy who's like really, you know, working out and eating right and doing all these things, he's going to recover quicker, you know, weeks instead of months. But for a lot of these guys, for everything to truly balance out, because hormones take a while. I always say, you know, in conventional medicine, again, our thyroid is disconnected from our heart, is disconnected from our knee, is disconnected from our testosterone, right? And that's absolutely not the case. Our body, especially our hormones and our neurotransmitters in our brain and spinal cord and our GI tract, they work like an orchestra together. And if you have an imbalance or a section is not playing the right tune, then the whole thing is discordant. So we have to balance all of those things. So it's one thing to take away the AI and let their estrogen come up, but we have to also make sure that their DHT is proper, their cardiovascular, all of those other things, get this orchestra all playing the same tune. And that's when guys are starting to feel substantially better.
Dude, such an awesome answer. It's always an individualized thing. You're right. If you're a fat MF-er, and you're destroying yourself, testosterone is not a panacea and it will take a lot longer. And then, you know, you brought something up, you make it easy for me. Now we have to talk about DHT inhibition. You know, just as we know that, you know, estrogen inhibition is a terrible failed rabbit hole, so is DHT inhibition. So for all those guys that are watching this show right now who will scream at me and they'll say, dude, whatever, you know, I'm using a microdose of, you know, finasteride or dutasteride, and it keeps me with a little bit of hair on my head. You know, I want you to, you know, go a little bit deeper on that. I mean, obviously you and I were talking off air, you know, we now know that, you know, DHT inhibition to solve hair loss is completely ineffective because it's not a root cause origin of hair loss. It's a secondary downstream, you know, effect. And if you do it, yeah, sure. Maybe it'll stop, you know, the attachment of the follicle, but, you know, after time, and again, knowing that what we know now from the drug, right, like again, dutasteride, finasteride, whatever, it causes so much other hormonal dysregulation that, like, why would you even want to use it? But can you kind of just talk about, like, your experiences in seeing guys that are using DHT inhibitors?
Absolutely. You know, kind of the same thing. Even if a guy comes to me and their testosterone levels are optimized, you know, so many guys that are taking any of those medications and blocking their DHT, they will say, I feel terrible. I have no libido. Well, but your libido is directly connected to your testosterone level. So this must be unrelated. Absolutely not. Just like that orchestra analogy I just gave, DHT is a necessary hormone in our body. We think about it in our minds that estrogen and DHT are bad. And we've thought about that historically for decades, because those are the downstream metabolites of testosterone, and they can't be good in a man because we need it to stay in testosterone. All three of those are working very synergistically together. And if you don't have enough DHT, you can have poor libido, you can have depression and anxiety, you can just feel terrible overall. And the other side of that equation is some of those medications like finasteride. There's a lot of research proving and then anecdotally just patient experiences with this, but blocking that and the systemic effect, for example, when you put something on your hair for hair loss that's on your scalp, you're not getting, or you're getting very small amount of systemic full body absorption right. of that. When you take a pill and you're blocking this major hormone that we need in a man's body, it's insane. It's absolutely insane. It's having liver effects and hormonal effects and all kinds of different things. It's terrible, terrible to continue to do that, especially these guys like we talked about earlier, that are doing this for years, if not decades, some of these guys.
I mean, Brandon, I feel for you, man. I mean, I don't even know how. I mean, look, man, I have stories, I'll break it here. I mean, I know guys, and you obviously deal with this every day, but like, I know guys have killed themselves. Okay. None of these people were like close personal friends, but they were confidants and associates and guys that I knew, from the gym world and just, being an influencer and stuff like that. But like post finasteride syndrome is evil. Like if you, are one of the guys, and Brandon, let's talk about it for a second. It's not talked about. It's heavily suppressed. The media doesn't talk about this because again, of course this is a Jay Campbell podcast, so I have no problem exposing, but this is a $4 billion a year industry. Okay. Mm-hmm. Big pharma is making a mint prescribing these drugs to men for hair issues. And as you know, the secondary effects, again, post-finasteride syndrome is, I mean, what is it? 30 to 35% of guys actually experience this. And we don't hear it. Obviously in your community, you know about it. I know about it in mine because I'm talking about these kind of things. But this is not on commercials when they're talking about getting, dutasteride or finasteride or whatever, minoxidil prescription. They're all working the same ways. I mean, they're not talking about DHT inhibition and the risks. And it's like you said, like dihydrotestosterone, okay, for the folks that don't know what DHT is very, very important for dopamine, right? Response to dopamine receptors in the brain. I mean, it literally allows the sense of well-being that men feel when they have optimized testosterone levels, right? Obviously, it's also a very powerful anabolic signal. So it helps with like erections. So yeah, if you suppress this powerful, molecular and biological cascade that DHT provides for well-being and for sexual function, what do you think is going to happen? But yet big pharma doesn't talk about this. And I have had many conversations with many physicians and researchers about this and how it's like, oh, well, it's not experienced by only a small percentage. I mean, dude, I have heard people say that post-finasteride syndrome is imagined. The guys that are feeling this are, it's just a psychogenic response that they create. I mean, it's mind blowing how crazy this is. So I want you to just maybe share for guys that you've worked with that have had obvious sexual dysfunction and lethargy and obviously depression from using this stuff.
Absolutely. I would highly recommend against it for all of the reasons that you just said. And then, kind of answer an earlier question that you asked, the length of time for recovery from these things is dependent upon many factors, like I said, but for finasteride in particular, obviously the longer a guy's on it, the longer the recovery period is. And I won't go into the details of the physiology and the science of this, but we have receptors on the outside of all of our cells, many, many different types of receptors. And when you either up or down regulate these things, it can take time for these cells to either make more of them or to take them away. And so when you have medication that is affecting not only your dihydrotestosterone or DHT, but it's also affecting the neurotransmitters in your brain. And like I said earlier, all of this is an orchestra. When you have an imbalance with your DHT that's negatively affecting your dopamine, which is your well-being feel-good hormone, right, that affects your serotonin levels. And now your doctor wants you to put you on an antidepressant SSRI medication because you have depression, not looking at what's happening on the hormonal side of things. There's a lot of people, I'll just share one research study that was done through the VA. It was a very large study. It was looking at like 47 or 49,000 male vets. And all of these guys were diagnosed with depression. So and we're on SSRIs. So these researchers went in and they said, let's look at the relationship between their depression and their testosterone levels. What they found was that the vast majority of these guys had low testosterone, not low serotonin. Okay, so, they put them on an SSRI medication. It keeps your natural production of testosterone around your system longer, which acts as an antidepressant. Well, what they found was when they actually optimized these guys' testosterone levels, their depression was mitigated. So, and I'm not, I want to make it clear here that depression is a very, very complex system, is a very complex situation, and testosterone is not a silver bullet for that, for sure. But what I'm saying is that there's a direct correlation with low testosterone and then low DHT with having depression symptoms.
Hey guys, what's going on? It's Jay Campbell. Quick commercial for the Optimized Tribe with U.S. Navy SEAL Michael Jaco and I every Monday night at 6 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. There is not a single group online where you will get the highest level intel that Michael and I can provide you, from mastering intuition to fully optimizing your hormonal health to improving your fitness to raising your vibration and increasing your consciousness. There isn't a single group online with two dudes like Michael and myself helping people become the best version of their self. It's literally $99 a month, and you get a 90-minute call with me and Michael every single Monday night. Don't wait another second. Sign up now at the link, theoptimizedtribe.com. I appreciate you guys, and I send you tremendous love and light. Your answers are a symphony. You're amazing. I mean, literally, yeah. I mean, it's very rare that I'm stumped. So like, I don't have anything to say that other than that, like, audience, I hope you heard that. And I hope you would listen to that again. It's very simple. Okay. We are not as smart as God. Okay. God created perfect physiological organisms to maneuver in this dense, dualistic third dimensional aspect of existence. So if you're going to use big pharma to inhibit a natural biological system or cascade, you're going to get side effects. And some of those side effects can literally F you up so bad that you don't even know what hit you. I mean, again, I've already talked about it, guys that I know have died, but dude, that was beautiful. And, ultimately you can't say, obviously we can't, even though we'd like to, we can't make this blanket statement that says, optimized testosterone will alleviate all depression, because you're right. Depression is multifactorial. There's a lot of root causes, trauma, things that happen to us in our early ages and stuff cause, brain changes. But I mean, dude, like, if there was, as we'll get deeper in a second, but if there was a biggest tool in the tool belt to use, it's testosterone, right? Yeah. Like, and I want you to, kind of share with me and the viewing audience, the idea or the aspect, and this is, your opinion, but also through your practice, like, where are we now, Brandon? Again, we're in 2021, we're in the middle of the year. The environment is so polluted. You probably are working with people that can't, have kids. I mean, fertility is on the massive decline. I mean, everything is just polluted. Okay. Now, for everybody, you're in Flagstaff. So you're in like one of the places that's least polluted, versus like LA, New York, Miami, Seattle, Houston, Atlanta, whatever. But, from a standpoint of, we know that testosterone is the biggest tool in the tool belt. We know that there is a, precipitous decline hormonally of men and women, dysregulation of endocrine systems. Fertility is an all-time low. We've never had a lower birth rate in the history of humanity, at least from a measured standpoint. When do you position testosterone to your patients? Like, how much do you go down the natural optimization route, every possible conceivable angle? Again, knowing that testosterone is the ultimate tool in the tool belt, and even bigger, that the environment is so contaminated, maybe not as much in Flagstaff, but you know, everywhere else, like, how do you separate, like, when do you know that the answer is testosterone for a prospective patient?
Yeah, it's an excellent question. And I was an RN, a registered nurse in the ICU in the emergency room before I became a physician. And I think that that gave me a very good foundation, a very good base for going into medical school. And one of the things in medical school that we talked about a lot is, you know, conventional medicine, from a conventional medicine standpoint, oftentimes we look at the numbers on a piece of paper. Okay, whether it's your cholesterol level, your blood, your A1C for your blood sugars, and you know, your hormone levels, any of those type of things, those things are very important. But you also have to look at the patient as well and what symptoms that they're having and all of those other things. And I tell my patients this every single day. I say, I'm going to look at your, the, you know, your labs, the numbers on your paper, and I'm going to look at you and talk to you and figure out what changes need to happen. So I have some guys, you know, in terms of the reference intervals on all of these labs, yeah, you know, most of the time, because they've moved the goalpost, okay, these labs, they keep decreasing the reference interval. Yeah, so they lower the low end and they lower the high end, so more people are normal in their levels.
Oh my God.
A huge challenge with that, because obviously, you know, you go into your primary care doctor and you're just told, well, it's not your testosterone, because look, you're 301 and you're, you know, starts at 300, so you're in the normal range. So it, again, my answer to that is it's very, very individualized. So you know, there's guys that will come to me with a testosterone level in the 500-600s on their total testosterone, and they have a sex hormone binding globulin elevated in the 80s or 90s or 100 or so, and then, you know, their free testosterone is still in the normal range because that goalpost moved, but they're at the low end of this normal range.
Right.
Well, they feel terrible, right? So the other thing too is, I wish that every single guy got their testosterone levels tested at 18 years old.
Exactly.
Baseline. If we all had a baseline, because, you know, if you're a 1500 total testosterone at 18 years old, and fast forward to when you're 35 or 40 years old,
you are destitute.
Or less, exactly. Well, you've lost more than half of your testosterone.
Exactly.
Level. Of course, you're going to have those symptoms, even though your levels are in the quote normal range.
Brandon, man, there's not many docs like you, man. I'm glad that the person that told me about you is not full of, you know what? I actually was just texting him as you and I were talking. I'm like, whoa! No, it's awesome, bro. I mean, you're exactly right. I mean, you know, I've said that on numerous podcasts, you know, in our newest webinar that just launched, it's exactly what I said. I mean, I, you know, if you're, and let's go back, let's take a step back. Let's look at this from a bigger picture. You and I know that in the World War I and World War II generations, dudes were walking around at 1,000 at a minimum. There were dudes walking around at 1,800, probably 2,000, right? There were no carcinogens. There were no environmental contaminants. There were EDCs. There wasn't even cancer, Brandon. Mm-hmm. I mean, we were living in a pristine, you know, ecosystem that we hadn't polluted and contaminated yet, right? Well, again, fast forward 80 years, 75 years, and now we're in a contaminated environment. So you're exactly right. If you were at 17 or 18 and you had a qualitative measurement and you knew what your numbers were, dude, that will, I mean, you got a lot of talking points on this podcast, bro, because no one has actually ever said that. But if you knew at 18 what your level was, that would allow you to determine the rest of your life when you were suffering from a deficiency, because you're right. You don't know a guy who scores, you know, and you, again, you hit so many points, you know, the standard mean deviations are being compressed. So, you know, a guy at 780, right, which is considered high, I mean, Brandon, he could literally be suffering from a deficiency if he was a 1700 or 1600 guy.
Absolutely.
And he's considered the high end of the range. So, I mean, the ranges are a farce. If you are a person and you are literally, again, as Brandon said earlier, going to a GP or a PCP, you know, thinking that you're going to get any kind of guidance in this, you are sadly mistaken, because they don't have a clue and they're going by ranges that are made up.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And I don't even fault the primary care doctors for that, because they have a million other things to think.
They don't know any better, dude. You don't know what you don't know.
Exactly right. And what you said was absolutely the truth. There was just like roughly 6 months ago, there was a study that came out that looked, did a comparison of the average testosterone level in men in the US today compared to 50 years ago. 50 years is a very short period of time. What they found was the average level in the US 50 years ago was 1/3 higher than it is today. 1/3, 33% higher than it is today. That is a huge decline. And my patients always ask me, well, why? Why is that? It's everything you just said. It's high stress lifestyles. It's not exercising, not eating the proper foods, and the toxicity that you cannot get away from. Air we're breathing, the plastics that we're eating and drinking out of that are estrogenic to our systems. And, you know, all of those type of things are leading to an extremely toxic situation in our on our planet. And then that translates into our bodies, and it's, they're hormone disruptors.
So, so let's talk about this. So, you know, we kind of already talked about labs. We don't have to go down deep down that rabbit hole anymore. I mean, as you know, the twofold, goal of optimization therapy is happiness and balance. You know, the late John Krizler, may he rest in peace. You know, we're saying that a long time ago. It's not about lab ranges or any of that. It's like, you know, do you feel good and do you feel balanced? And if you don't, then you probably are a candidate. But let's get deeper on that, you know, because you and I were talking off air. The environmental contamination is so bad now. The video game addictions, the porn addictions, the dopaminergic signaling rewiring in the brain, as you know, is happening now with kids that are literally below 20, Brandon. I mean, you know, you see kids who get tested who have 150, who are 19, 18, 20 years old, 21, 22 years old kids, right? Like they're dealing with testosterone levels of a 90-year-old geriatric, 85-year-old geriatric. So, you know, what do you say and what do you do, maybe is a bigger question, when one of those type of kids comes in? Because the average doc is going to send them away. You know, there's no way they can treat them with therapeutic testosterone. They're too young. You know, there's no, you know, standard of care in the industry. There's no, you know, peer review. I mean, what do you do with those guys? And I know this is a tough question, but you're the guy to answer it. Like, what do you do with those guys?
So, you know, and that is a huge, huge issue. I mean, I can't tell you the number of 20s and early 30-year-olds and from 18 to early 30s that are coming into my clinic now, just like you said, with testosterone levels, some of them have been in the double digits, which is
unbelievable. I've seen that. Like 78, 65, it's insane.
Exactly. But, you know, in general, in this 1 to 300 range, and a lot of it comes back to this lifestyle thing. So obviously you need to rule out some of the major things like pituitary tumors and things like that to make sure that there's no major problems going on that way. But once you rule that out, which most of the time is ruled out, you know, you need to evaluate where this person is in their life. Okay. Are they willing to make these lifestyle changes? Are they willing to, you know, get out, you know, out of the video game room and start getting themselves outside and connecting with nature and breathing fresh air and getting vitamin D from sunshine and, you know, all of those type of things. With a lot of the real younger guys, you know, obviously once you start on testosterone, it's a long-term treatment. So with a lot of those guys, what I'll do is just try to do those other things, some of those natural things. And then of course there's some, testosterone stimulants, right? So CG and Clomid or Clomiphene, those type of things. So I'll always look at those things with the younger guys. Sure. That being said, when you get to, you know, kind of your mid 30s and above, those things are generally not going to be effective at that point. You know, it's like, you know, until you get on testosterone, your symptoms, the way that you're feeling, are not going to be mitigated until we optimize your levels.
Brandon, you are amazing, man. There are very few doctors that will just say what you said. So credit to you. Thank God that you did. And I want to go deeper because you're amazing. So HCG and Clomiphene. Okay. Yes, they're definitely good adjuvants. They increase FSH, they increase LH, which is follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone, to my spiritual folks that follow you have no idea what I just said, right? But those are obviously important, you know, hormonal bioregulators in the body that will determine fertility. You're right though. You know, guys that have used those versus testosterone know that testosterone, again, is the biggest tool in the tool belt. It increases dopamine, response signaling. It increases enhanced feelings of well-being and mood. It increases cognition. It does so many other things that the adjuvants that stimulize LH and FSH, you know, don't do, that it's very noticeable. But obviously, again, a lot of doctors, you know, are playing by the rules, and they don't want to, like, you know, prescribe testosterone to a 22-year-old or a 24-year-old. And obviously everything you said is 100% right. You know, natural, 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 until literally they're about to kill themselves or something like that. But, you know, back to the HCG and the clomiphene, like, what are your dosing procedures, or like, and again, I know everybody's individual and stuff like that, and there's no cookie cutter template, but like, how would you dose a guy on clomiphene versus a guy on HCG? And do you use them sometimes concomitantly?
Most of the times I don't, and that's generally speaking from a personal preference for the patient and from a cost standpoint.
Sure.
So for the clomid or the clomiphene, you know, they come in 50 milligram tablets. Generally speaking, if a guy is young and doesn't have any, like, you know, traumatic brain injury, TBI issues, major concussion symptoms, all those type of things, historically, like, you know, which a lot of guys do from playing football.
Oh, yeah, dude. All the ex-military guys have TBIs.
Totally.
All
of them. Yeah, exactly.
They've been in concussive blasts. They're 100 feet away and they got a TBI.
Exactly. Exactly. So, you know, clomid or clomiphene, as you know, works on the pituitary and the gland in the brain to, you know, stimulate the testicles to produce more testosterone through LH. So, you know, the dosage there is going to be either a 25 or 50 milligram. Most of my young guys respond perfectly to a 25 milligram, and it pops them up into the 1200 range. Their free testosterone's, you know, 240 to 250, somewhere in that range. And they feel 100 times better. You know, right. So the dosage on the HCG, of course, this varies, but a lot of times, depending upon how low they're starting, these guys that are starting really low, you can do this more frequently, but in terms of how many injections you're doing per week and that type of thing, you know, a 500 IU twice a week regimen, works for a lot of guys. Some guys need less, some guys need more. It's all individual. We follow labs to kind of assess that. But you know, that's kind of generally where I'd start with some of those guys.
I love it. I want to go deeper with you. So for guys that are seeking, they're in their late 30s, they're in their early 40s, and maybe even in their early 30s, and they're, you know, HCG, clomiphene's not going to work. They know they want testosterone. They need testosterone. You've exhausted all options, but they want to retain fertility. What is your strategy of dosing testosterone and HCG together, or testosterone and clomiphene together?
Okay. So I generally do, for those guys, I generally do the combo of HCG. I do clomid as well with them, but HCG and the testosterone. And I know that you get on some of the testosterone boards, and there's a million different ideas, million different thoughts on this, but yep. So depending upon how the guy wants to do his testosterone. Okay. So if he wants to, like, I'm only going to, you know, be willing to inject once per week, and I'm going to do my testosterone once per week versus twice a week versus microdosing, right, 3 to 7 days out of the week. So if it's like a once a week injection of his testosterone, I'll have him do his HCG, 1 day before, 2 days after. Okay. Just for, to keep testicular production going. And again, there's a lot of different ideas, and I have different patients on different protocols from that. But in general, that's what I do. And then, you know, again, I would just kind of adjust that twice a week versus micro dosing and just keep that HCG going. And then, you know, obviously we're looking at their labs, we're looking at all their hormone levels, and they can, you know, they're going to be able to tell from a testicular atrophy, you know, or testicular size perspective, how things are going. And then again, you know, a lot of guys that do testosterone alone that shut down their natural production of testosterone, a lot of guys will feel better. Like, anecdotally, they'll just say, once they start on HCG, they'll just say, I just feel better. My libido's better. Like, I just, like, my mental status, my mind's not so cloudy, all of those type of things. So just from a quality of life standpoint, HCG can be very, very effective for a lot of guys.
Yeah, dude. Brilliant. I mean, obviously I'm older now and I've been on testosterone for a long time, and, you know, I don't obviously agree with that, but I'm totally in agreement with your rationale. I mean, again, and I know, right, there's luteinizing hormone receptors all up and down the body. And the theory, which is true for a lot of men, is that, you know, you're bathing the luteinizing hormone receptors, right? Because you're now on exogenous testosterone. So your body is shut off its endogenous. There's a feedback loop break. So you give yourself HCG, you know, again, to stimulate the LH. But for me, and again, there's a lot of guys like me, as you know, I don't need it. You know, I feel absolutely amazing on testosterone in isolation. You know, yes, I'm using desiccated thyroid, which we're going to, and metformin, you know, kind of hitting, you know, the optimizing the thyroid, optimizing the pancreas, you know, from an insulin standpoint. And then also, of course, optimizing your endocrine system from a testosterone. It's kind of like that holy triune, but you're totally right. You know, Dr. Jim Meehan, who's a great close friend of the show, you know, will attack me. You know, Jay, it's just not right. You know, he calls me J-boy. He'll be like, you know, you gotta have LH, you know, analogs or whatever. So, I mean, like, I get it, man. Like, you know, we're all different. We're all N of one. We're all biochemically unique. What works for me and me won't work for you and vice versa. And some guys like to have that LH, you know, stimulation. And, you know, Nelson Virgil, you know, was like me, testosterone in isolation forever. And then all of a sudden he started throwing in HCG at 55 or 56 or 50. I think it was 54, 55. And he's like, I love it now. And I hated it before it would give me, you know, a little bit of acne. I felt like it was another estrogen pulse that I didn't need. But again, the key is that as we age, our systems, our bioregulators, you know, our bioregulation in our systems are changing. Yeah. So are you going to change with it when something happens that requires you to change? I mean, it's all about, again, N of one, experimentation. What works for you might not work for somebody else. So, I mean, like, all of us should absolutely I would assume, work with a doc like you, who's going to evaluate these kind of things, you know, as you age, because again, it's all about happiness and balance. So, I mean, dude, your answer is phenomenal. Did you want to add anything else to that?
Yeah, I just wanted to add, like, you know, in terms of like protocols, right? Everybody wants this protocol.
There are none.
And you just said it, you know, everybody is individual. There shouldn't be an overall protocol for, you got 100 guys and 100 guys are doing the same thing. Half of my patients are on testosterone by itself, and half of them are on testosterone and HCG. Right. I give them, what I do on my practice is I give them all the information. I spend a lot of time with my patients, talking to them, explaining things, regardless of whether they're completely beginners here or they've been doing this for a long time. And I let them know what the benefits and the downsides and all that other stuff are. And then I help them to make the decision. But ultimately, I am the advocate for the patient. It's my job as the physician to, number one, do things properly, but number two, listen to the patient and make sure that we're getting them where they need to be. Do you need to take HCG with a testosterone program? I've had patients with me for 15 years that have never taken HCG once, They feel fantastic. So it's not necessary. And then the other side of that too is HCG, like I said earlier, some guys feel fantastic on it. Other guys are like, I didn't really see a difference. So a lot of times what my patients will do is if they've never been on testosterone, I'll have them do their first round of testosterone by itself, just so they kind of see what that feels like, have a new baseline. And then if they want to add the HCG afterwards, they can add that and see if there's an appreciable difference.
Brandon, you are amazing. I mean, there hasn't been one thing that we haven't covered here that I wanted to attempt to cover. And again, I appreciate your bravery, because a lot of these topics, you know, guys aren't going to go out there and talk about this, but I mean, this is going to help your practice and help me, because you're so, you know, you're an open book, but you're so clear and you're so transparent. Okay. I want to go, you know, a little bit deeper. I will just echo everything you said. We are all N of one. You should absolutely experiment with one without the other. Now, I would say, with the caveat that, as you know, if you're attempting to maintain fertility, you have to use, you know, either HCG and clomiphene concomitantly with testosterone. But you're right. I mean, again, I already used it, right? Like, Nelson didn't use it and now he's using it. And I've never used it other than when I was experimenting with it. And maybe I'll eventually evolve to where I have to use it. I mean, I'm open to that idea. Okay. So before I let you go, I want you to talk a little bit about peptides, about growth hormone optimization. Because again, this is the new frontier. You know, obviously I'm heavily involved in peptides. I'm working with my business partner on a course. It's going to be probably the first of its kind on the planet, you know, outside of what is taught to you guys in the clinical space, for people to learn how to use peptides. I mean, how many of your patients right now probably come to you and say, Brandon, you know, I watched Jay Campbell on a podcast, or I watched read an article, or, you know, Brent Greenfield, and I want to use this, this, and this. And you're kind of like, whoa, I got to first optimize your testosterone levels. You know, I get it. You know, you want to get to the elite, you know, tip of the spear, but let's take one thing at a time. But, you know, you're obviously very open about prescribing peptides and some of these other agents and stuff like that, which really, as you know, are the future of medicine, right? I mean, we already know that peptides and exosomes and like all these amazing, you know, growth agents, bioregulators. I mean, this is the future of medicine. I mean, we already know like BPC, a TB completely heals soft tissue and tendinous issues. You know, we have tesamorelin and ipamorelin and, you know, CGC, you know, one, you know, all these, you know, surmorelin, all these amazing, you know, GNR stimulants also enhance growth hormone and IGF-1. So we have these amazing, you know, analogs that do all these things, but I think it's important to listen to a practitioner slash a clinician like you who can kind of like, you know, push everybody back and say, first off, you have to educate yourself on how to actually use peptides. Cause isn't that the biggest point of resistance right now? Like the friction and resistance is like, okay, they watch Jay Campbell and Brandon on a podcast talk about tesamorelin, and we know that it rips through belly fat. But, you know, now it's like, okay, well, I bought it. I got it. He wrote a script for me, but what do I do next? Right? Because it's, there's a huge disconnect, right? Like on getting people to understand like how to use peptides, you know, when they'll actually be effective for you, right? Because I mean, how many guys that are 33% body fat are like, dude, I watched Jay Campbell's podcast and I want to start using tesamorelin. And you got to be like, bro, first you got to back off from the fucking table, right? Like first off, you got to lose body fat because a peptide is not going to magically transform you. You know, if you're at 12, 15% body fat, yeah, it will. And it'll be noticeable and you'll get in a single digit, but not when you're at that level. So can you kind of just like clarify how nebulous this world is with like all these people that want to use peptides? Because again, they're watching podcasts with people like me and you talking about them. You know, I want to hear your thoughts.
Absolutely. You know, and as you know, the peptide world in terms of getting them legally through a physician and everything like that, there's a lot of red tape right now. There's a lot of hurdles. You'll see peptides come out and be available, then they'll be pulled off the market. And I mean, it's a constantly moving target, unfortunately.
It's a dumpster fire.
It is. And unfortunately, you know, I've personally been, well, not personally myself, but I've been using peptides with my patients for 12 years now. So I've been using somorelin with GHRP6, right, injection for many, many years. Lots of my patients got great, great results, you know, yep, from the people who don't know exactly what we're talking about specifically with the growth hormone, secretagogues. You know, these peptides, basically your growth hormone is producing your pituitary gland in your brain, yep, and it's produced at night and it's used in many different functions in terms of healing, muscle mass growth, decreasing fat stores, healing hair, skin, and nails. All of these things are positively influenced by our growth hormone levels. And like our male and female hormones, as we're getting older, we're declining on our growth hormone.
Right.
Using some of these secretagogues, which just stimulate the pituitary gland to produce more of it, can be very, very beneficial for people. So, you know, the somorelin side of things, and then more recently, you know, one of the ones that's still legal for us to do is ibutamorin. And I've had really great results with ibutamorin with patients, you know, in terms of kind of stimulating that growth hormone and getting the results they're wanting. For example, yesterday I just had a patient. A relatively new, he's been with me for about 6 months, relatively new guy. And, you know, we optimized his testosterone and we put him on this and he's like, you know, I am 9 pounds up on pure lean muscle mass, you know, and he's like, people are like, what are you doing? You look great and all this other stuff. So there's a lot of benefits, that way. And, you know, it's, growth hormones is considered, you know, the quote anti-aging, hormone that way. So it does a lot of things throughout our body. So, you know, I'm a huge fan of peptides, obviously. And as we're able to use them more freely and liberally and legally and all of those type of things, you know, they will definitely be expanding in my practice.
Do you, awesome answer. Do you prescribe, actual growth hormone when there's a clinical need?
So it's a huge challenge. Okay. So yeah. Growth hormone, and yeah, I cannot tell you the amount of guys coming to me recently asking me for growth hormone.
Well, because they can't get peptides. That's, you just already knocked it out of the park. They can't get pharmaceutically graded compounded peptides.
Exactly. And so growth hormone is just so highly regulated by the medical boards, the FDA, the DEA, everything like that, right, that, you know, legally to prescribe it, there's only a few certain conditions that you can prescribe it for. And they're almost all short stature in children and things like that.
What is it? And maybe it's changed, but you know, the brain, the TBI, right? Like the glucostim test, that they fail that you can technically write it. But Brandon, we both know that even if you write them a script and they are, you know, they fall into that tiny, you know, where you can actually script them. It's so outrageously expensive.
People don't realize how expensive it is. You'll pay $2,000 to $5,000 plus per month,
just to get. And that's for a microscopic dose that won't do as well as the freaking peptide that you know that's at 1/20th the cost.
Exactly.
Nuts.
Exactly. And where are you getting your? You know, we measure growth hormone with the IGF-1 level in the bloodstream. Right. I have had patients in the past who have been taking actual growth hormone from elsewhere, and we have, you know, looked at the comparison between somebody on one of these secretagogue peptides versus growth hormone, and their IGF-1.
They're the same, dude. They're the same. It's absolutely the same. I mean, you know, I'm very open and honest about this. You know, I use growth hormone, not prescribed, you know, underground growth hormone when I was 33 for 6 months. You know, again, human guinea pig experimenting on myself. I can't become a top biohacker, you know, guy unless you do this stuff, right? And I felt like shit. I have a lot, you know, and this is way before 23andMe and Ancestry.com, but I mean, I'm a lot of Neanderthal, right? So it's like I have not high natural IGF-1 levels. And for someone like me, when I was 33, you know, using growth hormone, and I wasn't using a high dose, I was using like 2 IUs. But like I just had carpal tunnel, you know, old man feeling, you know, because I have already high IGF-1. So it never really did anything. I never, ever felt that on using peptides. And again, I'm very open about those. You know, I've used, you know, scripted peptides from TaylorMade. I've used stuff from Wells. I had Hollandale. I've used all these different compounding pharmacies when they were okay to do that. And, you know, my Tessa Morellin, the IGF on my Tessa and my IPA was always higher at 33. And again, this is a guy that has naturally high IGF-1 levels. So you're right, dude. Like that's the reason that peptides offer so much promise, because we know that they're far cheaper. Big pharma can't regulate them from a patenting, you know, angle like they do with growth hormones. So it's like, I mean, who knows? I don't want to piss big pharma off any more than I already have, but I would hope that, you know, at some point they give the peptide industry or the peptides themselves, you know, less regulation, more availability to physicians from not just from a scripting standpoint, but just an availability from the compounders right now. Because you and I both know, you go to the shows now, and all of the, you know, the vendors are peptide, or not peptide, but compounders.
Right.
Because it's still the wild, wild west. You know, I won't mention names, but, you know, some of the big people got regulated and so it got tighter, but all the small fries, dude, are still doing everything. And it's like, you know, you're not allowed to do that. Yeah, well, nobody's knocking on our door yet. So again, it's the wild, wild west. And, you know, we'll end the show, you know, we'll talk a little bit about, you know, my company, right? So as you know, we're selling products that are not medical grade, and totally within the confines of, you know, the supplement industry, as far as like what you can and can't say, but we're creating results that are, you know, absolutely what, you know, the average man or woman would consider clinical in nature, right? Like when you put a 3% grade of GHK, you know, copper peptide, GHKCU topically on your skin, it absolutely heals abrasions, cuts, nicks, because again, it's stimulating what we already talked about, you know, angiogenesis, better blood flow. It's basically a hack for the cells to upregulate and do what they would do naturally between, you know, the ages of 14 and 18, right? Yeah. So that's essentially what it's doing. And now the same thing with the hair, right? Like obviously, you know, you've seen my results. I mean, I was pretty much a bald dude. I'd already actually had the Vantus, you know, follicular replacement technology done in December of 2019. And now look at my hair. It's insane. I have to cut my hair every 17 days, right? So peptides are real. This is not hype. This is not smoke and mirrors. This is substantive, you know, use them and see the results. You've been using peptides probably in your practice for what, close to a decade, 8 to 10 years. You've seen, as you already explained, what happens to your patients. So I'll let you finish, you know, just big picture. Are we about to enter a golden age? You know, are all these biomedical, you know, enhancements and technologies that people are talking about that we're right at the forefront? You know, we didn't even talk about exosomes. You know, we didn't talk about PRP, but I mean, they're all there, you know, in the article that is coming from us. And then the podcast with Ben Greenfield, which, you know, this is going to be after. So people can already probably click on it when this thing runs, but you know, it's proving, we've proven that you can take GHKCU and carbon 60, add red light, you know, with a skull cap, you know, do, you know, PRP, you know, twice a year, you know, throw in some exosomes if you want to do it. And absolutely, Brandon, you will regrow your hair again, assuming you're not a fat person who's highly inflamed and comorbid. You know, you have proper blood flow. So we're already there. Yeah. You know, we're beyond the path of like hair loss is not figured out and nobody understands it. And, you know, we're beyond DHT inhibition. So it's like, we're already here. I want to get your thoughts, you know, again, big picture, where are we going from here?
Oh, there's so much potential. If there wasn't, obviously I'm not against regulation at all. Okay. But regulation to a certain extent. If, you know, and especially peptides and things like that, obviously they need to be prescribed, they need to be monitored and all of these other things. But there's so much potential with these things that would get people to the next level, get people healthier, get people you know, off of a lot of prescription medications that have tons of different side effects and are having interactions with one another and all of these other things. And again, you know, with Big Pharma, obviously this is not the direction that that Big Pharma wants to go. But there's so much potential out there. You know, if in terms of our bodies, and this is physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually, if we kind of get out of the way and we remove the obstacles to health and healing, it's amazing what's going to happen with our bodies. And just like you said, God created this absolutely unbelievable organism called our human body, mind, and spirit. And if we remove those obstacles and use some of these things that are natural, right? These are things from the earth here. I truly believe that we would see just some unbelievable changes, you know, again, I guess a physical, mental, and emotional standpoint with people.
Bro, I mean, this podcast has been so profound. I'm going to share your website real quick because I want to let people know. So guys, this is his website. It's grandcanyonclinics.com. I mean, obviously, if you've watched this entire podcast, you understand like the kind of doctor you would be working with. You want to work with Brandon. You know, if you're in California, Arizona, Nevada, you know, reach out to him immediately. You know, if you're on another part of the world and you still want to work with him, you know, just go to his website, check this out, click on forms. I mean, there are very few clinicians that make this like, you know, so available, but I mean, like go on men's forms, go on women's forms, download everything, send it to them. It actually goes right to them. You click it, you send it from his website. I can't guarantee that if you're in, you know, Miami or New York City that, you know, he'll be able to work with you. But I mean, I know that he will make every, you know, possible, you know, permutation to do that. But like, I mean, it's mind blowing, bro. Like, you know, you are the modern telemedicine doctor. You know what to do. You make it accessible. I mean, like I told you before, like I'm blown away that you're doing all this directly from your website. Most docs are still like, oh, you know, we'll call you, you know, we'll send you an email, you know, print the forms out. I mean, like everything is digital with you, man. It's, you know, it's credit to you and power to you that you have, you know, conformed your practice to work with the technology of today. Because as you know, medicine is like this gigantic barge in the ocean and it takes 50 years to turn the damn thing around, you know, just like with medical school, you know, they still don't even teach standard care of practice with hormones, which is a farce. I mean, again, they want people sick, fat, and dying, addicted to their pills. That's the formulation. That's how you make money. It's not to have docs who can literally treat them on a quantum level and heal them, which is what you're doing. So, right. Brother, I appreciate you coming on, man. You know, you get the final words and thoughts. Is there anything else that you would like me to promote about you and your practice?
You know, I just like to say, if anybody is interested in just even talking to me, I always offer free consults. I'm happy to talk to anybody if you have any questions that way. You know, in terms of becoming my patient, it's a very easy process. We do everything remotely. So we send you to your local lab to get blood work done. We just email, you know, fax it over to the area or to the lab, and then give you a copy of it. So we do everything, through telemedicine, which is extremely convenient, obviously, for all of our patients. So I'm very happy to talk to anybody, any questions, anything like that. And I really appreciate you having me on today.
Doc, you are absolutely amazing. So guys, GrandCanyonClinics.com. Check them out also on Facebook and Twitter at Grand Canyon Clinics. Definitely work with this guy. I mean, I give him my highest seal of approval. I do not know if I've ever actually done an interview with a physician who is as knowledgeable and as brave and as courageous as he has been on this podcast to talk about the things that we did at an extremely high level. So Brandon, again, thank you, brother. So guys, again, support him. If you are working with a physician that can't help you in the way that he can, you know what to do. Go to GrandCanyonClinics.com and remember, raise your vibration to optimize your love creation. We will see you guys very soon.